In the first unit of this section, we went through a lot of trouble to link matrices to linear transformations. Now, if matrices represent linear transformations, then maybe how we measure the magnitude of a matrix should be linked to how we might want to measure the magnitude of a linear transformation. So let's see where we get if we try that. So we have a linear transformation that maps a vector of size n to a vector of size m. Okay? What makes sense? How do you measure a linear transformation? Well, a natural way to me, how we might want to measure a linear transformation, is to look at by how much an input vector is stretched as it becomes an output vector. Of course, stretched could mean shrunk, but you get the idea. How might we mathematically do that? Well, if we're given a vector, we might want to look at how that vector is transformed, and then we would want to measure how large the output is. For that, we would need some sort of vector norm, but we've learned about vector norms. But we want to look at how much the vector is stretched relative to the input. So we would want to look at this ratio right here. And then we might want to say, but we want to look at all possible vectors and pick the one that is magnified the most and measure that. How do we do that? Well, there's something called the supremum, which is sort of like the max, over all vectors x by how much the vector is stretched. But you might recognize there's a problem. Dividing by zero, that's always nasty, right? So we simply say, let's not allow x to be zero. And now we have a definition of stretching. And we might want to say, maybe what we should do is make the norm of L defined by this. Now, there are minor details here, of course. What norm do we use to measure the size of the output vector, the length of the output vector? What norm do we use to measure the size of the input vector? Those are little details, and we work those out in the notes. What else? Well, if we then have a matrix A that represents the linear transformation, then we could define the norm of A to be the supremum over all x not equal to zero of A times x over x. And norms like that are known as induced matrix norms because they are induced by the vector norms that you pick for the input and for the output. All right. Now, it actually turns out that because when you scale a vector x, you can scale it first and then transform it, or you can first transform it and then scale it. It turns out that up here you can say, we could say the supremum over all x not equal to zero of L of x divided by the size of the norm of x divided by x divided by the norm of x. What's happening here? Because this is a linear transformation, you could bring this outside. Because this is a norm, we could bring this outside. Those two cancel, therefore it's the same as this. And what we now recognize is that this is a vector of size of length 1. All right, of norm 1. So what we conclude is that this is the same as the supremum over all x not equal to 0 of by how much a vector of
length 1 as measured by the given vector norm is stretched. Okay? But if you think about it, if you look at all possible vectors and you scale them to be of length 1, and then you look at it stretching, it's how it's being stretched, then you can also say, well, that's the same as the supremum over all y that have length 1 in the given norm of L of y divided by the length of y, but notice that this is just 1. Okay, so stretching, because linear transformations have the property that you can stretch the vector first and then transform, or you can transform the vector first and then stretch, and because norms are homogeneous, it's the case that the supremum over all vectors that are not the zero vector, by how much that is stretched, is the same as the supremum over all vectors of length 1, by how much those are stretched. And then there's one final detail, and that is, well, supremum, that's something that maybe you haven't run into all that much. Supremum really means the smallest number greater than. Okay? Wouldn't it be much nicer to just say the maximum? Well, it turns out that this set is a compact set. What's a compact set? It means that it's bounded, and it means that the limit of any sequence that's in the set is actually also in the set. It's a little mathematical thing that goes a little bit beyond this course. The upshot of it is that if you have the supremum over a compact set of a continuous function, and you can, it's not that hard to see that a norm is a continuous function, and that the norm of the linear transformation over y is a continuous function. That comes from the triangle inequality. And as a result, we can actually say, well, this is equal to the maximum over all y equal to 1 of L of y. Okay. And what is it about the maximum? The fact that we can say it's the maximum just means that in theory we know there exists a y where the maximum actually is attained, where the value is actually attained. And that turns out to be really important, because often we want to be able to use that vector that we know exists when we theoretically or practically talk about matrix norms. And then, of course, you can go back over here and say we can do exactly the same thing when we actually do think of it as a norm over matrices. And you can say, well, that's just equal to the max over all vectors with length equal to 1 of A times X. And you can go back here and say, and we could have just set the maximum instead of the supremum. And what we now actually have is an entire family of norms. They're called induced norms, because what you pick for the norm for the result of A times X can be a different norm for what you pick for the vector that's the input vector. And therefore, we now have a lot of choices.